Last year we got our first look at Apple's M1 MacBooks Air and Pro, and as the reviews came in, we could feel the winds of change on the horizon. The performance gains Apple made by integrating their custom silicon with ultra-fast memory were unbelievable. We held off on assigning them a repairability score at the time, in part because the technology was so different we weren't totally sure what to compare it to, or what repair expectations we should approach it with. Now with fully redesigned MacBook Pros on our table, we know that there are some parts of these machines that we're just not going to love, but we are at least determined to pin them down on their repairability scale. On the outside, the M1 MacBooks Pro take big strides backward, but in the best way. It's just over half a millimeter thicker, and MagSafe is back, right here on the left side of the laptop. On the right side, the card reader and HDMI ports are back too. It's almost like Apple realized Pros need ports. Between the speaker grills, the keyboard now lives in a black well, and the new ProMotion Mini LED displays look great, except for that notch. Speaking of the display, under a microscope you can see just how effective that mini LED backlight is. In a high contrast part of a web page, you almost can't even see the pixels in the dark areas. Scrolling down, you can see high contrast text is a little less crisp, but still impressive. Sorry MacBook, but your cries for help will be ignored today. On the underside of these new laptops is a fancy MacBook Pro label embossed onto the bottom cover. I must admit, it's a nice touch. To get our first look at what we're up against, let's take a look at some x-rays from Creative Electron. It looks like the 14-inch MacBook Pro in this x-ray shares a lot of the same internal design language as the previous Pros, with a sprawling 6-cell battery and angry owl eyes. Between those eyes is the new M1 Pro package. Through the heat spreader, you can see there's a lot going on under there. Moving on to the disassembly table, the lower cover is the first thing to go. 8 Penelope screws hold it down, along with 2 of those tenacious clips and those nasty metal teeth along the top edge of the aluminum case. The only good thing about this design is you know this cover isn't coming off if you accidentally lose the screws. Inside, I can immediately see the fans are noticeably bigger than the previous 16-inch machine, and the speakers, already huge in the older machines, get even more space with the thicker chassis. Apple mentioned with this new speaker design that the woofer, what you're seeing here, can displace more air for up to 80% more bass. It's hard to verify that one, but it is cool to watch it dance. There are a few minor differences between this 16-inch M1 Pro model and the 14-inch Pro model, but they aren't very significant. To see more of the little guy, and a bonus teardown of Apple's new polishing cloth, check out our blog post at the link in the description. Last thing to call out before we begin, something we never thought we'd see in a Pro MacBook. Sweet, sweet pull tabs around the battery. This is usually a sign that the designers have taken battery replacement into account by using adhesive that works like a command strip so that it can be removed easily. I'm trying not to get my hopes up, but this is promising. First item on the agenda is to disconnect that battery. To do that, I have to first disconnect the trackpad cable here. Underneath, there's one more cable, and then a large screw which holds down the battery contact pad. Lift that up, and the battery is disconnected. Now onto those pull tabs. The speaker makes it hard to get at the tabs easily, but I'll give it my best shot. The first one goes alright, only breaking once. We really love this kind of adhesive because... We really like this adhesive because... Alright, just forget about it. There are 4 more tabs on the left side, but before I do those, I want to see if there's an easy way to get this speaker out of the way. Short answer? Nope. The speaker module continues underneath the board here, so it's gotta stay put for now. These 4 strips come out with satisfying clunks, and we're left scratching our heads over where the pull tabs for the 2 cells in the middle might be. While I was applying some isopropyl alcohol and about to start prying, we realized they might be hidden under the trackpad. Sure enough, removing the 14 Torx screws holding down the massive pad revealed precisely cut holes giving us access to the precious pull tabs. These strips are now soaked in isopropyl, so they come out silently, which means I can finally say what I was trying to say earlier. We love this kind of adhesive because while it's not reusable like screws, it is at least removable, greatly simplifying battery replacements and preventing dangerous prying. This 6-cell battery has a total capacity of 99.6 watt-hours, which is actually slightly less than the old 16-inch MacBook Pro. M1 repairability woes aside, an actual removable battery is a huge step forward for the MacBook Pro lineup. One of the only good things about the USB-C only MacBook design was that the ports were at least modular. In the new Pro, removing these cable brackets allows me to disconnect the MagSafe, USB ports, and headphone jack, but looking closer I can see they are also fastened to the aluminum below the logic board. Drats. Modularity here is a win, but to do a replacement you would have to remove the whole logic board. Next, I'll unscrew the heatsink and the antenna hardware that runs across the top of the machine. These are still tiny P2 screws, but at least there are fewer than in the old design. As the big antenna bar comes out, you can see it's been redesigned to accommodate the larger holes for evacuating hot air from the laptop. To remove the logic board, as always, it's a cable disconnecting frenzy. Many of them have their own brackets or fragile black stickers covering them. After everything is disconnected, I can carefully wiggle it free from the right, sliding out the soldered on HDMI and SD card reader ports on the left. Under the heatsink is some color matched thermal paste, wow, such Apple, and under that thermal paste is, well, nothing exciting here, or here, but under here, an Apple logo, and oh boy does that shield scratch easily. This is just a spudger, so I'm thinking, scratches at a level 1 with deeper grooves at a level 2. Let us know what you think, Zach. More on this M1 chip and its impact on repairability in just a minute. With the board removed, you can see this new display cable design, something I am so relieved to see. There's now plenty of slack in the cables as I open and close the display, and the bracket has been simplified, which is nice. These cables are still built into the display, but I didn't really expect that to change. If you're not sure what I'm talking about, go check out our FlexGate video. The long story short is that in early iterations of the previous MacBook Pro design, Apple made these cables too short, so they tore when you opened the laptop too many times. At first it was a real, you're using it wrong moment, but they did eventually admit something was wrong and come out with a repair program for it. Just a few things left in here. Next, I'll pull out one of these fans. Like just about everything else, they're held down with Torx screws, two of which are hidden under these sticky stickers. The fan design is pretty similar to the old 16-inch, though these are definitely capable of pushing more air thanks to their larger volume. This teardown is already running long, so I'm just going to admire these modular ports from a distance. They're fixed to the chassis with more Torx screws. The definitive list of modular ports is all 3 USB-C, the headphone jack, and MagSafe. The HDMI ports and the SD card reader are both soldered on. The speaker is locked down with some serious glue. Heat helps a bit, but there's no great way to heat everything evenly, so some prying is required. This tight adhesive seal helps create the phenomenal sounds these speakers make, so at least this muck has a purpose. Finally, let's talk about that Liquid Retina XDR display. It's secured with 3 beefy Torx screws under a metal shield on each hinge. This display is quite a piece of work. I wouldn't be surprised if this is at least a third of the laptop's total production cost. If you're rusty on your mini LED knowledge, pause here and go watch our iPad Pro video from earlier this year, where we took the display apart to see the fancy backlight and explain how it works. Basically, instead of lighting up the pixels from the edges, mini LED displays light them up in sections from behind, greatly increasing contrast and peak brightness. Interestingly, the backlight on the iPad we took apart had over 10,000 mini LEDs, and Apple claims this larger 16-inch screen also has 10,000 mini LEDs. In theory, that means the MacBook Pro display would have fewer dimming zones and more noticeable blooming in high contrast scenes, but word on the street and what we're noticing here in the office is that these MacBook Pro displays are actually better at handling contrast. I'm guessing Apple spent some time improving their optical films and diffusers for these displays. On top of all of that, this thing also supports ProMotion or variable refresh rate up to 120Hz like the latest iPhone Pros. If it weren't for the notch and these baked-in cables, I would call this a perfect laptop screen. It's pretty amazing. Alright, enough stalling, it's time to talk about repairability. Apple's M1 silicon is rocketing the industry forward in a bunch of ways, and it's unfortunate that progress comes at the cost of modularity that a truly pro laptop deserves. We've done as much research as we can, but we still can't say for sure whether these types of performance leaps are even possible with current socketed memory and storage limitations. Though we do have our eyes on technologies like Intel's new Alder Lake CPUs with dedicated efficiency cores, PCIe 5 connectivity, and socketed DDR5 memory support. By way of comparison, our scoring system doesn't punish smartphones for not having modular memory and storage because of the obvious space and size constraints, and the lack of industry standard sockets for such components. Up until now, the divide between laptops and smartphones has been clear, so it's been an easy distinction to make. But since M1 is kind of like a beefed up smartphone processor, those lines are blurring fast. It's complicated. M1 conundrum aside, these new MacBooks Pro have other repair follies. Penelope screws on the lowercase are completely unnecessary, and even the process of removing the cover after the screws feels like it was designed to be scary. And while I don't want to undersell the importance of the newly removable battery, Even friendly stretch release adhesive can be a pain if it breaks on you, and having to remove the trackpad to get to the last strips is confusing. The thing is, this problem has already been solved elsewhere. Just put the battery in a frame and fasten it with screws. I promise nobody will mind the extra millimeter, Apple. Beyond the battery, it's nice that most of the screws inside these machines are Torx, and the logic board removal process is much smoother than the older Pros. It is still annoying that you'll need to remove the whole board to thoroughly clean your fans, though. Also annoying is the fact that you can't perform screen or fingerprint reader replacements without negative side effects. Swapped screens lose True Tone functionality, and swapped fingerprint readers lose their Touch ID powers. All things considered, the M1 MacBooks Pro, 14 and 16 inch, earn a 4 out of 10 on our repairability scale. For now, this score includes a penalty for integrated storage and memory like any other laptop would, but if we learn that this level of performance is truly impossible without that, we will readjust our expectations. After all, there are ways to make modular, repairable computers without socketed storage and memory. And the goal of the repairability score isn't to hold back progress, it's just to keep these companies accountable.